So Mr. Plotkin and I were talking before that he said to me, if I mispronounce your name, don't make a face or else I'll kick you. And I told him, well, my legs are longer and I played soccer. I'll kick you back. Hi, everybody. Welcome to the 2016 City College Commencement Ceremony. Thank you for the warm introduction. And to the families in the back, the students in the front, it's kind of like a rap song, isn't it? to the distinguished guests, to President Koiko, there you are, to Chancellor Milliken, to Senator Schumer, and that's it, right? Oh, yeah, okay. First Lady Michelle Obama, that's actually her, she's really here. Thank you to all of us for being here today and celebrate this moment with us. I've got to tell you guys, public speaking and I sort of have a weird relationship. It started about a year ago when I was asked to speak in front of a group of prospective engineering students in the Great Hall. And I had never spoken in front of an audience that large. It was about 200 people, and so I was pretty nervous. And my speech went with a lot of stuttering, because I was nervous. But it was going okay until I got to the end of it when I was supposed to say, I've had a lot of success here. And instead, it went something like, I've had a lot of sex here, success here. So of course, all the students in the back who were falling asleep did something like, and started hysterical laughing at me. And then there were deans of admissions, deans of engineering, and they all started hysterical laughing. I'm like, oh, well, that's it. You know, like, forget about public speaking. I can't go to college anymore. I can't live in New York anymore. I'm like leaving the country. I'm done. But since then, I've learned to start all of my speeches with that story, kind of as a way to like break the ice, and it works pretty well. I've never told anyone about my sex life since then. But jokes aside, eventually I have to follow up Aruba's beautiful speech with hopefully something that's also inspiring. So I'm going to talk about our collective City College experience, and I'm going to begin with where I'm from. So I grew up in a town in Long Island that is predominantly third-generation Italian-American. I heard some woos, all right? And so what it means to be in a town where everyone is third-generation Italian-American is that, one, no one speaks Italian. Two, everyone has Italian last names, which are mispronounced because no one speaks Italian. And three, everyone's mom cooks lasagna on Sundays. And so I have a really long Greek name, which is mispronounced all the time. But my mom is Italian. Rose, right there. And so I'm also a third generation Italian American. And so my mom cooks lasagna, the other kids' moms cook lasagna. I get it, we all like lasagna, we can get along. It's easy for me to be friends with people from where I grew up. And then I came to City College, and I was surprised to find out that not everyone is part Italian. In fact, some people, and this might sound crazy, are not Italian at all. Like Mamma Mia, you know what I mean? And so at this school, it's not only true that people come from all over the world, but also people have really different life stories. You know, for example, before I came here, I didn't know what an undocumented student was. And today, they're some of my closest friends. I had never seen a single mother work full time while raising her children and putting herself through college, but I have now. City College is full of people from different walks of life, and we try to express this through the word diversity. And you'll hear that a lot here. There's tremendous pride at CCNY for our diversity. You know, in fact, we've heard it a few times today, and I'm really excited to see if the First Lady will talk about it in her speech. You know, if not, I can stall here. Maybe, like, you could pen something in. Yeah, just let me know. I got you. They got nothing to do today anyway, so. You know, the problem with all these impromptu things is that I lose my spot. I don't know where I am now. Oh, okay, here we are. So when I was a freshman at this school, right, I remember hearing people talk about diversity all the time, but I didn't really understand what it meant. And I absolutely did not understand or appreciate what it's worth. You see, my definition of diverse at that time was just having people maybe with different skin tones, who were born in different countries, or who grew up speaking different languages. And while that's part of diversity, while that contributes to its overall meaning, it's bigger than that. More broadly, I think diversity is can be defined as people who've had different life experiences and struggles that I was not aware of, people who have lived through specific events that I had not been exposed to. And because of that, they've grown into people who think distinctly differently than the way I do. So what I'm telling you is that diversity of people gives rise to diversity of thought. And what's the importance of this? What's the importance of this? What's the importance of mixing people together who think in different ways, who view the world from different perspectives, who come from different walks of life? Well, I'm studying to be an engineer, and that means I do a lot of group projects. And so if you were to ask me about the difficulties of working in a team where everyone comes from the same walk of life, where everyone thinks the same, I'll tell you. You know, if everyone on a team wants to be the leader, the person who calls the shots and does a lot of the forward thinking, that team will fail. If everyone on the team wants to be the organizational secretary who keeps notes and has everyone on a strict timeline, that group will fail. And again, if you have everyone who wants to be the technical engineer who does the software development and the hard coding, that group will fail. But if you have a team with one technical engineer, one leader, and one organizational secretary, now we have a team with potential. It's a potential to make it through college, potential to make it into the professional world. So you see, diversity of people ultimately makes more productive and efficient teams. It allows us to be a stronger student body, go on to be a stronger workforce, economy, and a stronger nation. And that's my first message to you, that we are stronger as a community and as a nation if we are diverse. The second message is that being exposed to diversity at City College has enhanced our education. And to explain this, I'll talk a little bit about my personal goals. You see, I want to become a leader in the medical field, but without City College, having grown up in a predominantly racially homogenous town, I would have been exposed to something like 5% of the American population. And how could someone coming from those roots, knowing what just 5% of America looks like, make medical decisions that will affect 100% of the population? For all the knowledge that engineers and scientists have, would we be of any value as leaders if we are not aware of the struggles of the people we are meant to serve? Absolutely not. As students of City College, you have learned that while you take classes alongside people from all over the world with different walks of life, it is equally as important to learn from the professor in front of the room as it is to learn from the student sitting beside you, a student like Aruba. The greatest gift this school has given us is that it has allowed us to become multidimensional scholars who are not just competent in our fields of study, but who are aware of the world around them and the people in it. Any school could have taught you to be an engineer, a writer, an artist, an architect, an economist, or whatever. But only at City College, only with this diversity, could you have learned something about the world that is not written in your textbook. Leaders who appreciate this diversity are so important and unique that they've come together through national and world organizations to create the diversity that we have here, beginning with the International Olympic Committee, the League of Nations, and even the United Nations. It is the ultimate goal for people in this world to be able to learn from one another and live together peacefully. That idea, that mission, is what prompted President Barack Obama to say that we are not black states, we are not white states, Latino states, or Asian states, but the United States. And I say to you, esteemed First Lady, you can tell the president that his dreams for our nation have been alive and well at City College for decades and will be for decades to come. We can learn a valuable lesson from leadership that understands the importance of diversity. It is wrong to alienate people who are unlike us. It is wrong to judge people because they did not grow up the way we did, because they did not also grow up eating lasagna. And as sons, it's her cooking, okay. Y'all are invited, dinner, Tuesday, our house. All right. See you there. All right. It's pretty cool, right? As the sons and daughters of City College, you are well prepared to assume leadership roles in your fields because you have learned that communities and nations are meant to grow and prosper as whole entities by considering the well-being of all its people, not just those with the loudest voice, not just those with the privilege of being heard. Okay, all right, all right. Before I return to my seat, I owe a couple thank yous. And the first one is to my mom. So, sincerely, from the bottom of my heart, I love you too, Mom. For those of you who don't know, I'm moving in, I know, right? That's what she's saying. I'm moving to California in the fall for graduate studies. And so while I'm really excited about that, not so much the school part, but the beach part, but you know, my mom is pretty sad about it because she's like, well, that's the other side of the country. Can't you go somewhere closer? And but here's a promise to her and all of you as witnesses that you are free to visit me whenever you want. I will come back home as often as I can, and you can expect good morning text. How's the lasagna coming along?
Morning text.
Morning text. She's gonna follow me up on that one. Her threat is that I'm out of the will, but I'm like, come on. Do we have to be petty like this, Mom, really? In front of everyone. The next one is to my baba. You have always been a source, okay. You have always been a source of inspiration for me in terms of academics. A large reason I think today why I'm pursuing a PhD is because of the PhD that you pursued. And I think it's something for both of us to be really proud of, that the Mourdoukoutas line has gone from farmers in Greece to two generations of PhD students in America. People say that Geminis are supposed to be bipolar. That's a little bit of my bipolar, where one's really mushy and lasagna loving, the other one's very serious and studious. So there you go, that's where it comes from. And thank you to my brother, my sister Eleni, my Nana, my GP, to my professors, to the Honor Center crew, in particular to Dr. Bixon, Dr. Vasquez, who's somewhere over there, I think, to Jennifer Lutton, Susanna Urich, to Alita McKee, to my friends, to my roommates, to my BME crew, my kidney squad, you're somewhere over there, I didn't forget, all right? And most of all, to the class of 2016, thank you for the privilege of learning alongside you and from you, because I'm a better person today having had that experience. Congratulations, everybody, and good luck.